Thank you very much, Professor Misail. It is surely an honor to talk to people, actually, because, you know, I am in a university at Udaipur, and coming down and talking to people in IIT, I suppose I'm talking to the cream of the country. Honestly, saying that, you know, basically I'm not a metallurgist. I'm basically an archaeologist, and, you know, due to my, you know, long experience, field experience, I gradually picked up interest in archaeometallurgy. Did a lot of survey for ancient metal, metal making, etc. And in course of time, I realized that, you know, zinc is something which we need to sing very well. It has not been done so. Professor Misail wanted me to speak on copper also, but since I was away in the field, I requested him, you know, please do not assign me copper because I will not be able to do that. I have just returned back from the field work also. So I just chose to talk on zinc. Why zinc? Maybe if there are people from history background, I would say zinc is very difficult to smelt. Because what happens, you know, when you heat metal like copper, iron, you get these metals in the form of semi-liquid form or, you know, solid form. But when you heat zinc, it gets lost. So that was a problem. So it is this, due to this, you know, problem, zinc being volatile metal, was perhaps, you know, people were not able to do it or not bring, not obtain zinc in the metallic form till very late compared to the history of other metals. So I, you know, since I've been working at Udaipur, and the zinc production happened at Zawar, which is very close to Udaipur, hardly 30, 35 kilometers. So therefore, you know, I gradually, you know, visited that place, tried to understand, and of course, there are people, those who had worked on zinc right from 1982-83. I'll show some of the pictures of those people, those who actually discovered the zinc making industry there. Then, in course of time, I had opportunity to do a book on zinc. Why I chose, you know, to do this, because, you know, this brought big name to the country also. Therefore, I love to talk on zinc rather than copper or iron or other things. Of course, iron is also the same. But we do not know if, other than any, you know, place, other than Zawar, zinc was produced at industrial scale anywhere outside India prior to Zawar. So therefore, it brought big name to the country. Therefore, I always love to talk on this. The area of Udaipur, which is southeastern Rajasthan, is full of lots of monuments. A large number of monuments, actually. The monuments you see in that area, they were made since, you know, there was prosperity. That prosperity was brought about most probably because of metal making, lots of metal making. Not only zinc, but also people were making copper and other metals. So this, you know, metal making may have brought prosperity, and that eventually allowed the local rulers to do lots of monuments in that area. So these are some of the monuments of that area. This is the palace area of Udaipur city. It's a tourist place, so people love to go to that this place. What is the use of zinc, actually? Why do we need it? What happens, you know, zinc is primarily used to make brass in ancient times. But ever since, you know, metal was used for, in medicines, in late historical times, somewhere around 8th, 9th century AD, later than that, of course, not earlier than that. So zinc, you know, in the powder form was also used in medicines. And there are still people around, they're still making bhasmas. So this is there in the Ayurvedic text, and all alchemy, materia medica, that was done post 8th, 9th century, you do have copious references of zinc in those texts. So this is, you know, a zinc cannon at Udaipur, very close to Udaipur bus stand. This one, this is brass cannon actually. Why brass? Brass actually, you know, is interesting. It doesn't get rusticated. And zinc is primarily used for galvanizing of metal. So when you in all our houses also, you have you know, this gas kachula has coating of zinc very often also, so that, you know, that galvanizing is very, very important for long life of the metals. Possibly it is doing the same thing. If you have any cut in your body, whatever medicine you, when you go to the doctor, any medicine you get, there is always zinc in that, so it is giving life. So therefore it is called yasad. Then, you know, what happens in ancient times, this brass was made by number of ways. If you have less than 4% zinc in brass, that is accidental brass, not intentional one. But if it is, the percentage of zinc is more than 4% in brass, then surely it is intentional selection of the ore for making zinc. Then you have something called deliberate brass by cementation process. In that case, you have more than 4% and less than 28% of zinc in that. This is, you know, in that case, zinc, your brass is done by cementation process. If the percentage increases more than 28 or it crosses 33, then surely in that case, that brass is made by mixing zinc metal into copper. So this is, surely that in that case, if it is 33% or more, that means people knew how to extract metallic zinc. So this is proof of that. You know, this brass in ancient times was, you know, it was prized because of its sheen. And there are lots of sites in India where you have experimental stage of brass. I mean, the early evidence of brass that comes from some sites called, one is Hastinapur, that is in Ganga Valley. Another is right in Gujarat, and from Lothal, if you have a fragment of brass. And there are a number of textual evidence, references to brass, right from, you know, Kautilya's Arthashastra, Ayurvedic text. Then there is Ratnakara of Nagarjuna. Then there is Rasanroa, Rasvarnam, 800 years old. Then there is Rasata Samuchaya, RRS, which is also published by, you know, INSA, Delhi. Then there are lots of, you know, foreign references to brass, Chinese, Persian, British, Greek. These are some early, you know, examples of brass in the ancient Indian text. With other metal, brass has also been, you know, registered. Of course, when I was talking about Hastinapur and then Ataranji Kheda, these sites belong to Iron Age, dating back to 3,000 years old. And from Lothal, from Takshila, there is a site called Takshila, which is in now in Pakistan, Takshashila. From there, actually, the earliest evidence of metallic zinc was discovered. I mean, brass was discovered in which amount of zinc was more than 33%. That was the earliest evidence of zinc in South Asia. Then there is a site called Sinuwar in Ganga Valley, where also you may have a brass in which the amount of zinc is more than 33%. There are references to brass, you know, in ancient India. For example, there was a Bihara at Nalanda, at Timargarh graves, brass coins are known. There are a number of icons also. There are a number of brass making centers right in Gujarat itself. For example, Lilwadev, Mahudi, and Akota. These are three brass making centers in Gujarat. Of course, medieval one, but there are other places also, you know, where brass was being made. There are we knew from the literature that the Roman brass is very famous, but we never did much homework to learn that, you know, our Gupta kings were also making brass coins. They are also known. Now this area I'm showing you, you know, the Arauli Hills, which are more like polymetallic zone. We have lots of copper in the northern area of the Aravallis, in areas of Jaipur, Sikar, And in central part of Aravali, you have lots of lead in around Ajmer. But when you come down to the southern part, you have lead zinc. So this is the area of Aravali, and this shows the geology of that area. And the zinc metal is associated with the middle or Aravali group of rocks. This is again the same area, showing metal area. This is Zawar. In India, what is very, very interesting is that in many places you have a suffix name Pattan. You see, this is Zawar is also known as Yogini Pattan, Visakha Patanam. Patanam is basically for area from where trade was being operated. So there are lots of places in the country from where during ancient time trade was being operated. Zawar was one of them. Zinc was being traded. Therefore, the name is Yogini Pattan. Yogini is a tantric deity, basically. And this is the view of Zawar. This is the panoramic view of Zawar. What you see in the center is a Jain temple. And this Jain temple is actually resting on ancient remains. There are lots of ancient remains underneath this very temple there. And there are large, huge heaps of, refractory material of zinc in this area. Large number of open and underground mines also. This is just a stratigraphy of, this area. What you see here, this lead zinc is, associated with carbonate association formation here in the middle Aravali group. So, what is interesting is that these are open mines in that area. In most of the hills in that area, you have open mines, serpentine open mines. It is interesting that, people in ancient time, they were able to extract zinc ore, which was sphalerite, because it looked slightly brownish. It differed from the, rock with which it was associated. Therefore, they were able to separate it with naked eyes. So from these, what you see here, this is an ancient open mine. You have another open mine here. All these, in most of these, this is an open mine in Zawar. In most of the hills, you have such open mines. There are also underground mines. Underground mines were done up to a depth of 150 meters below surface. This is a wooden structure at Dariba. Dariba is a lead smelting place, actually, lead making place, where this wooden structure was made. It was when it was dated, it came out 2,300 years old. And this is a fragment of basket which was discovered from a mine. This is also dated, same date, 2,200-300 BC. So people may be, taking out all the debris from the mines with the help of such baskets, bamboo baskets. This is an open mine here, and this is a stope here, and these are, circular pits. These pits were used for grinding the ore and making it in the powder form. This is an inscription of King Samar Singh at a site belonging to early 14th century. So this inscription actually speaks about the beginning of mine in that area. These are underground mines. You can see how the mining has been done this way, and there are ladders, stairs, and you can see, chisel marks on the rocks in the mines. This is a wooden launder here for transporting water in the mines. When the Britishers came here in the in the early 19th century, they tried hard to reopen the mines, but they were not successful. The smelting was being done till 1812. After that, the smelting almost stopped. This is a figure published by Paul Craddock in the cover page of his book. It shows how the mining must have been done in Zawar. These are some of the tools which they were discovered from the mines. They are actually iron tools. They were discovered. They are very simple tools from out of which the actually mining was done. There are, you know, references how the mining was done. Maybe they were initially heat, you know, lighting lots of fire in the mines, then pouring water in that. So there are literary references to this kind of, you know, mining in the Arthashastra also. So this reference talks about that. This actually shows, this map shows the area of mining. There are three different zones. This is one, this one is Mochia one. Here is the Baroi mines, and the third one is Zawar one. So from Zawar area, actually, most of the evidence what we have here is from Zawar. This, on the left side, these are actually, you know, ancient mines. This is just plan of the ancient mines, how they did mining in that area. Now you can see the, you know, lump of ore here on the right side. Here you can see veins of ore in the rock. So they're easily visible. From Zawar itself, there were a hoard of coins was discovered. These coins belong to the period of King Akbar. And this particular pot, which is here, is datable to 2nd, 3rd century BC, belonging to Mauryan phase. This particular shape is, you know, it belongs to early historic phase. So is the case of this terracotta bowl. These are the people, those actually who discovered this area and Zawar and did excavation. This is H.B. Paliwal, former director of Hindustan Zinc. In the center is Paul Cadoc from British Museum, London. Here, this is K.T.M. Hegde, Professor Hegde from M.S. University, Baroda. This is the second last person is Krishnan, Professor Krishnan from Baroda. And the last one is Professor Ajit Prashad, who heads the Department of Archaeology, M.S. University, Baroda. This is very old picture of 1982. This is, of course, not the entire team, but these were the people, those who actually, you know, started working at Zawar. Well, this is Professor Sunawane here. They have just discovered this smelting furnace. This is Paul Cadoc's wife. This is Professor Ajit and Professor Bahan. So all these people from MS University, Baroda, Hindustan Zinc, and British Museum, London, they were involved in discovering this area. This is the discovery of zinc smelting furnace, seven furnaces together in a row. And this was amazing discovery that happened in 1982. Prior to that, no one knew that India made zinc, that too on commercial scale. How it happened, you know, this is again the same picture from a different angle. They were able to, this is view of the excavation. They were, you know, there were, you know, brinjal-like retorts. They were kept upside down in a perforated terracotta plate. I'll show you in the coming slides. 36 retorts were, they were able to place in one furnace, and in one, you know, a zinc retort could give them about 400 grams of zinc, provided it could accommodate about 1 kg of raw material. So in one shot, about 25 kg of zinc they were able to obtain. I'll show you some of the pictures. How this is excavation going on at Zawar. This is this terracotta plate. A better picture is coming in the coming slide. But this is just how the beginning happened at Zawar. You know, it's a quite large, huge area. I mean, very difficult to identify where exactly the smelting furnace would be, because it, you know, you have a number of heaps, huge heaps of retorts, you know, lying in the whole area of Zawar. I'll show you some of the heaps. This is, you know, how this was done. It was roasted initially. The zinc ore was roasted initially to get rid of its sulfides. Then finally, then it was broken and in the powder form. It was mixed with cow dung, semi-dried kind of cow dung. Small, you know, balls were made, and then they were inserted in a retort. I mean, I'll show you that retort in the coming slides. These are the heaps of refractory material, I mean debris which was out after smelting when it was discarded. So these are heaps. People are standing on those heaps. Such heaps are, you know, all around Zawar. Well, this is actually the model of the furnace here. What you see here, this terracotta plate was, you know, made in four parts, four equal parts. And then it was kept on this kind of squarish furnace. And a small terracotta stick was, you know, kept in the center to give support to the terracotta plate. This is visible here. This is visible here. I'll show you this in the coming slide also. And this is the base of that. This is that, you know, terracotta stick, which was kept at the, you know, base to give support to the terracotta plates. The furnace had two chambers, one upper, another lower. In the retorts were kept in the upper chamber, upside down. And the vapor that was obtained was in the lower chamber, where it was condensed to obtain the, you know, zinc in powder form or in metallic form. It is like this. These are the actual retorts from Zawar, and this is just, you know, drawing of it. How it was made in two parts. These retorts were made in two parts, and after inserting the filling the charge in those retorts, the retorts were ultimately eventually looted like this with clay, and finally they were, you know, placed in the furnace upside down. This way. This is the furnace here, and the furnaces may have looked like this. So, you know, from the literature, what we learn is that they used cow dung, local wood, to fire that in the upper chamber on top of the, you know, retorts. So the firing timing may have been somewhere around four to five hours. And the temperature may have reached something like 1,000 degree or a little more. So maintaining a 1,000 degree temperature 4 to 5 hours may have been hectic job. You know, raising it to 1,000 degree, you know, just for half an hour or small time is easier job. But maintaining for 4 or 5 hours may have been really, really incredible work. So how did they do that? We don't know. But then we need to do a constant trial. How did they do it? Yes. Can you repeat the question?
Yeah. I
still did not get your question. Concept of
the concept of the retort.
Yeah.
Why use such retorts?
Yeah, this is again sort of innovation at Zawar. We do not have any earlier evidence of retort from anywhere in the country, anywhere from Asia. And since zinc was, you know, done in India, it was innovated, it was made on industrial scale in India for the first time. Other evidences from rest of the world come much later than India. So the peculiar kind of, you know, brinjal shape, long retorts were made from local clay. We tried to do it from clay from outside, but we miserably failed. We did it here in IIT Gandhinagar a year ago, but we miserably failed. Last time, we picked up soil from Zawar made retorts ourselves in our department. We were partially successful, but we still need to do more on that. Many of the retorts we did, they got broken while heating. So, of course, we need to do experiments how they did it. We tried to understand the retorts because most of the retorts are broken available there. So by observing, we used lots of tempering material, like, you know, tempering material local tempering material to mix in the retort clay. But then still we failed. Retorts were made in two parts. The upper part was, you know, like cap, The lower part was like, you know, bottle kind of thing. It is possibly because they use small balls of the charge, they filled it, then they finally capped it and then looted the bottle. This is what we all understand by the discovery of Zawar. But last time when we did it, it was really, really big problem, because when we were placing the upper cap part in that bottle one, there may have been a stick what has come out of the research. There might have been a wooden stick, I'll show you in the coming slide, that inserting that wooden stick in the bottle was a big problem. As many as time we did it, our retort got broken. So maybe if I have that slide, I'll show you why it was that difficult. Of that wooden stick, what, you know, when you place that retort in the chamber and fire it, so what is going to happen, the temperature is gradually raising and it will go beyond 1000 degree. So what will happen when it is beyond 1000 degree and it is there constantly for four or five hours, the wooden stick would burn. And that wooden stick, as long as it is there, it will not allow to fall down the charge from the nozzle, because there was a long nozzle, you know, attached to it. And once it is burnt, the vapor right from, you know, bottom of that bottle would come out and reach to the lower chamber. Is it clear? I can even show you in the slide. Sir, maybe it is then more clear. Okay. Yes.
So, because of the high temperatures, did these structures have a limited life?
Can you repeat the question, please?
Sir, you mentioned like these structures are made up of terracotta and clay, and they are sustained to a very high temperatures. So did that lead to a short lifespan, or did they have some solution for that as well?
No. Your terracotta, actually, that the structure was made out of stones using mud, the furnace. And the bottles, they were, of course, terracotta bottles. And, when they are heated up to a temperature of 1000 degree or more, what happens then, you know, your terracotta material starts putrefying. You just remember sometime you visit the place where bricks are made. So what happens, you know, in the kiln, when the temperature goes beyond 1000 degree and there it is there for quite long time, many bricks where the temperature is constantly more putrefy and their shape changes. They are useless then. The brick maker throws them away and dumps them somewhere around. So that kind of, you know, situation is there in most of the retorts at Zawar. That shows the temperature was surely more than 1000 degree, because less than 1000 degree, generally we have lots of pottery from number of archaeological sites that is generally fired at a temperature ranging between 700 degree and 1000 degree. So nothing happens to that. That kind of vitrification is not visible in the pottery generally. But in case of retorts, most of the retorts are vitrified. Is it clear? This kind of nozzle was there on the cap part attached to it. And there may have been a wooden stick which was inserted in this right up to the base of that bottle. So that, you know, once that is burned, the vapor would come out. So the vapor, what happens in case of zinc, actually, zinc, if you heat it, its melting temperature is just 415 degree. But the boiling starts somewhere around 930 degree or so. But to get the vapor, your temperature has to go beyond 1000 degree, otherwise the vapor is not going to come out. So to obtain that vapor, and maybe obtaining vapor was not that problematic issue. More important, more hectic issue was to condense that vapor. So in the upper chamber, the temperature may have been around 1000 degree, but in the lower chamber, the temperature might have been brought less than 400. Otherwise, you are not going to obtain the metallic zinc or powder zinc in powder form or solid form. So bringing down the temperature suddenly from 1000 degree to 400 or less than that may have been a big problem. How did our people do that was surely a miracle that they did at Zawar. We have, some literary references for zinc, in Rasratna Samuchaya and Rasratna Kara in 7th, 8th century, when the, bhasma were made, there are, lots of furnaces, they are given in the ancient books also. This is one of them, how the zinc was made. And people in India, they are still doing this. Of course, that is being done at laboratory scale, just for making medicine, they are making zinc. They are not buying zinc from bazaar, they are still doing it. So this is more or less same kind of procedure. This is just a picture done by Paul Kadok's wife, how zinc was being smelted at Zawar, how the furnaces may have looked like, and how the life may have been around. So this day she did. She was actually one of the participants of the excavation team there. I think this is important to bring to your notice that this is Forbes, an eminent European historian of science, in 1964, he writes, it seems that zinc was prepared by Indian chemists since the 12th century, but this remained a laboratory experiment and it was never applied to industrial production. Just remember these lines. Just remember these lines. This is saying laboratory experiment. I'll show you industrial one of the same date. So this is, I would say this is a distortion of understanding. Or Eurocentrism, I would rather say it. I'll come back to this issue a little later, but let me take you back to Rasratna Samuchaya. Many of our ancient texts explain how zinc was actually made. This text talks about different types of zinc. It talks of different types of ore, for example, rough kharpar. Then it takes, when they are heating it, what happens, they were observing the flame. This is what I have, changed the color of the text here. When the flame issuing from the molten calamine changes from blue to white, the crucible is caught hold of by means of a pair of tongs and its mouth held downward. Means, the flame they were observing, possibly a certain kind of flame that was coming out, they realized, it is done. So this is surely for laboratory scale, not for industrial one. Yes.
What would be the Sanskrit word for zinc?
This is yasad, which comes much later, but there are other words which are coming earlier. They are coming in the following slides. This is Rasratna Samuchaya again, saying how zinc was made. It is saying same thing. This brinjal kind type retorts were made. And it also gives a measurement with fingers. Angula, it says, 12 angula fingers, and how it was done, what material was mixed to it. All this text is, explaining. This is published in Indian Journal of History of Science also. This kharpar is one of the word for zinc. Kharpar is one of the word that is generally for ore. Then there is rasak also, rasak. R-A-S-A-K, rasak is also used. So these texts again, say, on the basis of text only, I'm saying that, it must have been 4 to 5 hours work. 4 to 6 hours took to complete the process of smelting, and it produced 20 to 36 kg of zinc from one furnace, depending on the size of furnace. There were 2-3 different sizes there at Zawar. Because the it is based on the size of retorts. There were 2-3 different size of retorts they are discovered at Zawar. Based on that, we are saying perhaps there were 2-3 different types. So what happens, condensing the vapor, what I said must have been quite difficult. The idea of condensing vapor might have come from the local liquor making. The liquor making has a very long history in India. The earliest evidence goes back to 3rd century BC, somewhere in northwestern India. But in alchemy, lots of this distillation processes have been explained. So even now across the country you have this distillation process going on local liquor making. So this is a local liquor making process, and it is being done using distillation process. So the condensation of that vapor coming out from zinc, it required a distillation, and that was a downward distillation. And that downward distillation idea might have come from this local liquor making, and it has a long history. So possibly this was used by the local people to make gin. Anyway, this is just, material that was mixed to the ore to make gin. It talks about the reducing agents also. Now this is the, these are the heaps. Just two heaps I'm showing here. Earlier heaps I showed you where people were standing. This is just close view of those heaps. This is refractory material. I mean, material that these are actually fragments of zinc retorts. After smelting, they were thrown away. So these are heaps. So I'm sure you will agree that this is no laboratory scale. This was surely commercial or industrial scale. Paul Craddock and his team calculated that there is about 600,000 tons of this. So it cannot be laboratory scale. You can see episodes of dumping of this refractory material at Zawar. Those who are doing the metallurgy, once they use these retorts, smelting, they use those retorts as bricks to make their houses. These are walls of their houses actually. Those who were smelting at Zawar, so these are walls of their houses. This site has been actually very well dated. Large number of radiocarbon dates, both for mining as well as smelting, have been done. So the dates for mining go back to 4th century BC. I mean, there are of course 2-3 dates going back to 6th, and there is one date going back to 13th century BC also, but we are not considering that since there is no consistency. There is, from 4th century BC, there is consistency of dates for smelt mining at Zawar, so also at Dariba and Agucha. But for smelting, there are only dates available from 9th century AD, but from 12th century AD, I mean about 800 years ago, there is consistency of dates. Means there is no doubt, there are number of dates, ranging between 12th and 18th century. So for 600 years, this industry was surely flourishing and doing lots of big, huge production at Zawar. So these are all radiocarbon dates. They have been all published. Again, dates, radiocarbon dates again from Zawar. Now what happened, once the discovery happened in Zawar, then those who actually discovered it, they started looking for its trade. Where was it going? So a public record office, comes from London. There is the reference to Indian zinc. That was the one of the earliest reference from the West it came. Then there was somebody called Libavius, an alchemist of Holland, received Indian zinc in 1597 from a friend, which he calls peculiar kind of Indian tin or Malabar lead. It is referred by Forbes, 1950. The same person who said this is a laboratory scale, the same person has referred it. Then there is the Eastern Indians have long been in possession of the method of extracting pure zinc from the ore, at least in the country of last century. This metal has been brought from thence to Europe. Genghis mentioned the importance of zinc from India in 1647. And in Diri Minerabilis, a metal of this kind under the name of Tutenag is still bought from thence. This word Tutenag is very interesting because Chinese also made pure zinc almost 300 years later than India, Indian zinc. They also sold their zinc via India to the West with the same name, Tutenag. So this Tutenag is actually Indian name, and it is also recorded in Chinese text. Now, I was explaining the production to you. This is the just detail of that production. In one retort, if you have 1 kg of charge, so the 400 grams of zinc will be obtained. In one furnace, 25 to 30 kg. Depending on the size of the furnace, the amount may change, the quantity may change. But ranging from 25 to 30 kg of zinc in one shot. So if you have 10 furnaces, you can calculate how much of zinc you are producing in one shot in one area. So there may be thousands of such furnaces actually in Zawar. About 600 tons of smelting debris at Zawar, that has been recorded. And in 600 years, 12th century to 18th century, about 32,000 tons of zinc was produced. This is a rough estimate, of course. And this is just for 400 years, but if you take into consideration dates from 9th century, because there are 2-3 dates from 9th and 10th century also, if you consider from 9th century, that the amount will double. So then in the local records also, you just see one reference of Colonel Todd. Todd was a political agent in India, and he wrote a gazetteer of Rajasthan. It is very well known as Annals and Antiquities of Rajasthan, a thick book, very well known. He writes, in the year 1759 alone, the mines of Zawar earned rupees 2,22,000. This is the amount that was earned in 1 year. This amount, 1759, must have been huge. This turnover must have been huge. This is the archival record again. It also talks about Zawar. This one talks that, about 2,49,000 rupees were earned. And this says 2,50,000. So, it's a huge amount that was coming from the mines. At Zawar, there was a treasury, actually. There is a fort at Zawar. And in that fort, possibly, there was a treasury. And for that treasury, there are 22 records, archival records. They are available at Udaipur. These records explain how much money was kept in the treasury. Just see carefully. I'm just, marking here. You see, this is amount, actually. These are bags of money. So these bags of money, they were kept in the treasury. So this treasury has, for trade, right up to the southern India, to the Bahmanis also. Of course, to number of other places. This is that, entrance of that fort where this treasury must have been. This is plan of that fort. This is a sun icon that is discovered inside this fort. And this is a brick temple just outside the fort. Unfortunately, this brick temple is about to go now because the Vedanta company is, mining like anything in that area, which is destroying the archaeological remains. These are number of temples. There are several temples in that area. There are Hindu and Jain temples. And several temples have icons, also inscriptions ranging from 12th century to 19th century AD. Lots of other inscriptions in that area. This is a Jain icon, sitting posture. And these inscriptions also talk about Akbar and Mughal kings. Now this, what you saw, your retorts kept upside down. In the same fashion, your Brinjal shaped retort that was kept upside down in the furnace, in the same fashion, William Champion in 1736 made a furnace at Bristol in England with the same model, keep making the huge retort, keeping upside down for downward distillation. And this is on the left side is his brass making industry at Bristol. In 1738, he made zinc there, got it patented. So zinc was made at industrial scale in India from 12th century. And Chinese started making zinc from later than 1521, from late 16th century. And rest of the world, they did not know zinc till 1736. William Champion, 1738, 36, he made this furnace. I don't know from where the idea came out, but Paul Kodok, who actually discovered Zawar or who worked at Zawar, his team, they strongly believe that William Champion learned this downward process from Zawar. I don't know who came to Zawar, how the idea went from Zawar to Bristol, and 1738 it got patented there. But of course it was not good for Indian part, but then there is something good happened. I'll show you that evidence also. This is Chinese process. This is upward zinc making process. Indian one was downward, and this Chinese one was upward process. The distillation is happening here, and finally the metal is being collected here. And there is a book called Tengung Kaivu in China, dates 1637. This book talks about Tutenag. This book says that, you know, zinc is not known there, but the Tutenag comes from somewhere outside. They do not refer it to India, but say this metal is coming from outside. So the word is interesting. It is a South Indian word derived from Tutha. Tutha is in Kautilya's Arthashastra used for metal. And it is a South Indian word. Tutenaga is a South Indian word coming from Andhra area. You are asking for the terms. So in India, the Indian brass is called Arkur, which is there in Arthashastra. Then Riti, Ritika, Pital, Brinj, Rututya, this is all for brass basically. Indian zinc is called Puspanjana, Stav, Rasak. Rasak are different kinds of rasak, you know, different kinds of zinc actually. So Britika Rasak, Gula Rasak, Pushan Rasak, three different kinds. And then Kharpar you have, then Jasad, then finally Yasad. So there are different names of zinc ranging from, you know, early centuries of Christian era down to 16th, 17th century. Then for in Greece also you have number of terms which are used for brass. So also in China, but what you see in Chinese and Europeans, you have the word Tutenag again. This is an Indian word which is used by Chinese at the same time by Europeans also. The early claims of zinc were made from number of places initially, but for example, Athenian Agora, Telgazer, this is in West Asia, Argentina, Namagza Depe in Central Asia, Bern, Switzerland, British Isles, and in China. There are, these are number of places where it was claimed that there is zinc, prehistoric zinc. But all these, except for Asia Minor, nowhere zinc was known. The only site we have in Asia Minor, other than that, it is only Takshila, which yielded the early evidence of zinc. Now here, just I want to show you, you know, the analysis of Takshila, you have this 34.34% of zinc in brass. This is 3rd century BC, prior to the arrival of Romans in, you know, Takshila. Prior to the arrival of Sikandar at Takshila, the people at Takshila were making brass, you know, mixing metal to copper. So we don't have any direct evidence of any furnace dating back to 3rd century, but there is brass which clearly indicates that people knew zinc, 3rd century BC in South Asia. There is another evidence, that is Sinwar. I have already said it. Sinwar also have 35.5% of zinc. This is in Ganga Valley. This is a reference from Charak Samhita about how zinc was known to the early Indians. There is something called Bidri ware in South India. It's very famous, you know, ware, basically decorative material. And it has gold as well as zinc. We don't know if this zinc was transported from Jawar. We have no reference, no evidence to it. But this ware certainly have zinc. Other than that, there are some coins from Himachal Pradesh, these on the right side, these are called Jittel coins. They also have zinc. But we do not know if these coins of Himachal Pradesh, they have any connection with Jawar, or zinc was transported from Jawar. No idea, but Paul Kadok suspects that there is zinc smelting area somewhere in Himachal Pradesh. Of course, not decided so far, not excavated, not reported so far. This slide, just I was showing you the area where zinc is discovered or zinc smelting is discovered has a very long history of human occupation right from Stone Age. You have bronze age, large bronze age settlements, lots of rock art area. People are doing lots of kinds of crafts in that area. So possibly this long experience of metallurgy, settlements, civilization possibly brought the idea of zinc to the people. So this is the material what you are seeing here is Ahar culture material, which is a Bronze Age culture contemporary to the Harappan civilization, almost same date, and they were making different structures, of course of stones and bricks, and they had about 116 villages in that area. These are some of the metal objects of those people. Such huge heaps you find in the Aravallis where people were doing smelting. This is a smelting site, copper smelting site of Khetri, which is in North Rajasthan. Not even Khetri, this is called Singhana actually. This is a huge heap on top of which actually there is a fort which is also made. Use copper smelting slag. Now this zinc, I would like to read this because this is very important. On one hand, William Champion got zinc patented in England. On the other hand, there is a reference from Royal Society. It reads that the site are preserved, the zinc retort distillation furnaces and remnants of related operations. The technical sophistication and application of scientific principles are unparalleled elsewhere in the medieval period. The elements of standardization and mass production foreshadow the industrial revolution. This is the earliest example of high temperature distillation operation. It's very important, I suppose. The later part is ruins of exotically carved temples and other village artifacts attest to the success of this metallurgical operation. The operation first supplied zinc for brass making used for fine instrument making in Europe, a forerunner of the industrial revolution. I think this is very important that, finally Royal Society agreed that something very important happened at Zawar. Unfortunately, we could not patent it here. This is another board. There is some mistake in this, but this is American Society of Metal. It reads, at this site are preserved, almost more or less same text, but it has small mistake. At this site are preserved the zinc retort distillation furnaces and remnants of related operations. The village artifacts together with temples ruins attest to the success of this metallurgical technology. This operation first supplied the brass, actually not brass, should have been zinc. That is the only small mistake in this, otherwise more or less the same thing. So these two bodies of the world, Royal Society and American Society of Metal, both agreed that something very important happened at Zawar, and it is forerunner of the all sorts of pyrotechnologies, high temperature pyrotechnologies, and this is the first area where zinc was actually made. So it should actually be a site of UNESCO, should be protected by UNESCO, but unfortunately what is happening, the area where zinc is produced now is also under mining. Here is a geologist. Actually, I'm bringing this reference to you because a couple of years ago when I was surveying that area, I happened to visit geology departments of Rajasthan State Mining Department and GSI departments also. I was questioning them how many new deposits have been discovered after the independence. So I was stunned to listen from the geologists that we have not discovered any new deposit. We are only working on the old deposits. Most of the deposits are already known. So it is interesting. I'm sure Dasuraji will agree to it because this is what I was told. So all the entire Arauli part, right from your northern Rajasthan areas from Jhunjhunu down to your Ambaji. Ambaji is in North Gujarat. It has been mined thoroughly for copper, lead, zinc, and to your surprise, we have learned now, the Harappans were obtaining copper from the Ambaji in Kutch. So at Dholavira, a site Professor Danino is working, the copper was obtained at Dholavira from Ambaji. And it is very interesting, Ambaji also has huge, large dumping of, you know, slag. Thus, the zinc smelting process of Zawar appears to be the result of long experience of archaeometallurgy, use of metals in medicine, long history of distillation technology, continuity and transition in cultural processes, and a strong traditional knowledge system in South Asia. All these factors perhaps contributed to the development of underground mining of metals in the first millennium BC and production of pure zinc on the commercial scale at Zawar from 12th century AD, if not earlier. I therefore salute to the ancient metallurgists of Zawar who stole the show by innovating distillation technique for pure zinc and made India feel proud forever. This is a book long back I was able to do on zinc. This was the Mauryan pot that was actually discovered from the mine. So this is a typical shape of the pottery, terracotta pot, which was common between 3rd, 4th century BC to 3rd, 4th century AD for almost 400-500 years. After that, it doesn't appear. The shape changes, of course. This is a small picture from Zawar, smelt slag from Zawar. This is zinc sheet. Yeah, this is, I think this is repetition of some figures. Yeah, this is a zinc, you know, block for, en route. This is Chinese zinc, not Indian one. Of course, this is ingot that was being transported to Europe through India, of course. This is the location of Himachal Pradesh, where we suspect zinc was made. This is, if proved, this will be the only second place in India, in whole of South Asia, where zinc may have been made. Of course, we have yet to do a lot of work in that area. But it is only one place in India, Zawar, where zinc was made. This is the picture of experiment of this campus we did last time here, but we miserably failed. We did the second attempt at Udaipur, but again we failed because there was some problem of temperature. We could not maintain it for 4 hours, 5 hours. We were closer to the success, but then we still have to do maybe one or two more experiments. Maybe this is end of it, and I would like to have suggestions, questions, comments, and whatever. Thank you for listening.